Good evening. Ministers for the sick and homebound, please leave your picks with the sacristans in the sacristy before Mass begins. Mass will start shortly. Thank you. Good evening. Welcome to St. Mary's Cathedral. Please take a bulletin to follow along with the music for this Mass and to learn about what is going on in our cathedral community. The second collection today supports our cathedral music program. Your donation enables us to offer the choirs, cantors, and visiting musical artists, as well as the music direction and conductors who are responsible for the high quality of music, which is an essential component of our cathedral liturgy. Thank you in advance for your generosity. Please stand.
Thank you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with
your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words,
in what I have done, and in what I have failed to do,
through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin,
all the angels and saints,
and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Christ.
Let us pray. O God, who have commanded us to listen to your beloved Son, be pleased, we pray, to nourish us inwardly by your word, that with spiritual sight made pure, we may rejoice to behold your glory. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the book of Genesis. The Lord said to Abram, "Go forth from the land of your kinsfolk and from your father's house to a land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you and curse those who curse you. All the communities of the earth shall find blessing in you." Abram went as the Lord directed him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let your mercy be on us as we place our trust in you. Lord, let your mercy be on us as we place our trust in you. Is the word of the Lord, and all his works are trustworthy. He loves justice and right. Of the kindness of the Lord, the earth is full.
Lord, let your mercy be on us.
Of the Lord are upon those who fear, upon those who hope for his kindness, to deliver them from death and preserve them in spite of famine.
Lord, let your mercy be on us.
Our soul waits for the Lord, who is our help and our shield. May your kindness, O Lord, be upon us who have put
let your mercy be on us as we place our trust in you.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to Timothy. Beloved, bear your share of hardship for the gospel with the strength that comes from God. He saved us and called us to a holy life, not according to our works, but according to his own design, and the grace bestowed on us in Christ Jesus before time begun, but now made manifest through the appearance of our Savior Jesus Christ, who destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus took Peter, James, and John, his brother, and led them up a mountain by themselves. and he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, conversing with him. Then Peter said to Jesus in reply, "Lord, it is good that we are here. If you wish, I will make three tents here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud cast a shadow over them. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell prostrate and were very much afraid. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Rise and do not be afraid." And when the disciples raised their eyes, they saw no one else but Jesus alone. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus charged them, "Do not tell the vision to anyone until the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. As I welcome you all here to our cathedral this evening for this Mass, I'm especially happy to welcome today the Pueri Cantores here for their the National Student Choral Organization of our church. And here we're hosting their this Mass for their Northern California Choral Festival. So we're so very happy to have you with us, as well as a number of other accompanying choirs, youth and children's choirs. So you're very much enhancing our ceremony today, so we're delighted to have you with us. And we come together for this event during the season of Lent, Lent being a time of penance, a time of mortification, to use that old word, of self-denial. And perhaps this is something we've gotten away from over the last many years. The church, of course, a long time ago, lighten the rules for fast and abstinence and penitential discipline, but it wasn't in an effort to de-emphasize it or to kind of convey that it's not important. It was quite the contrary. The church wanted people to freely choose to take on acts of penance rather than simply obeying a law. So be a more mature kind of spirit of penitential discipline. So we seem to have gotten away from that, but I suppose this is nothing new. I came across this comment from one liturgical reformer about this question. He said, "How few Christians do we meet who are strict observers of Lent, even in its present mild form? And must there not result from this ever-growing spirit a general weakening of character, which will lead at last to frightful social disorders? Those nations among whose people the spirit and practice of penance are extinct are provoking God's justice to destroy them by one or other of these scourges, civil discord or conquest. The word of God is unmistakable. Unless we do penance, we shall perish." Seems very fitting for our own time, but these were the words of the abbot Dom Prosper Guéranger,
who was the abbot of the refounded Abbey of Salem in France in the middle of the 19th century. So already he was lamenting the lightening and of this spirit of penance. The church presupposes we're taking the spirit of penance seriously during Lent, which is why on this second Sunday of Lent every year, the church presents us this gospel story of the transfiguration of our Lord on Mount Tabor with his three chosen apostles, Peter, James, and John. The idea is that the church reminds us of the glory of Lent, rather the glory of Easter that's at the end of the tunnel of Lent. So to give us encouragement that we don't become discouraged by the fasting and penance that we're doing, but we'll be motivated as we keep our vision fixed on the glory of the resurrection. So this then presumes that we're taking this seriously. It's a way the church teaches us this perennial lesson of the fact that without self-denial, there is no path to glory. This is a season of self-denial, but we're reminded that the way to true glory is not self-indulgence, but denying ourselves things that is more a spirit of generosity, of being other-centered. It's a basic lesson, and actually it's a lesson Jesus teaches right before this scene of the Transfiguration in the Gospels. He says, whoever wishes to come after me, this should be familiar to all of us, right? Whoever wishes to come after me must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. So this is the path to glory with Christ, the happiness we seek with God. It's this path of self-denial, of dying to self, being generous toward others. And the church has us experience this liturgically so we can begin to learn how to live it out in our day-to-day lives. It's kind of a pattern the church has in her liturgical life. When there's a great feast day to celebrate, there's a period of preparation. Then the celebration, and often an extension of it through, for Easter, for example. Easter is, we have the great vigil and Easter Sunday, but it's a whole octave, 8 days that really celebrate Easter. Then it's a whole season, and then there are special feast days after the Easter season ends that harken back to Easter to bring out the mysteries of the meaning of this great truth of our faith. We have the Solemnity of the Sacred Heart, the Solemnity of the Body and Blood of our Lord, and so forth. To put it in an abbreviated way, you might say that this is the pattern of fast and feast. Before a great feast, there is always a fast. And indeed, we cannot really feast well if we haven't prepared for it by fasting. So we actually then, at this time, live out liturgically what the apostles were experiencing at this time in the life of our Lord as they were traveling with him and learning from him. At this moment, they get a glimpse into Christ's glory. He revealed this to them right before his passion and death, again, to prepare them for it. He wanted them to be ready so they wouldn't become scandalized and fall away. Pope St. Leo the Great teaches us this, where he says, the Lord was transfigured so that he might take away the scandal of the cross from the hearts of his disciples, and so that the humility of his voluntary passion might not disturb their faith once the dignity of his hidden excellence had been revealed to them. As we know, as it turned out, it did disturb their faith. They were scandalized, they were afraid, and they abandoned him. If I can go back to Dom Guéringer, he explains this about their denial of Christ a few days after this experience of the Transfiguration. He says, the three apostles were exposed to a terrible temptation when they beheld their divine master robbed of all his majesty. But how easy it would have been for them to resist the temptation by thinking of what they had seen but a few days before. Instead of that, they lost their courage and forgot prayer, which would have brought their courage back. And thus the favored witnesses of Tabor became cowards and deserters in the garden of Mount Olivet. We too are subject to the same temptation. We fall just as easily, which is why the church gives us these reminders. The purpose of this season, to intensify our prayer, to be more intentional about works of charity, and to take seriously acts of penance. Penance, we can deny ourselves things in a number of different ways, but we should not avoid bodily penance. It's good to fast from other things, fast from television, fast from social media, and these sorts of things. But we should always include some form of bodily penance, bodily fasting. The church understands the human person. We know that the human person is composed of body and soul. It's one integrated reality of physical and spiritual. We have a tendency today to dissociate these as if the body is one thing and the person's identity is something else, and all these sort of different compartments. But we're one being, and we have a physical and spiritual aspect to us. Bodily penance, denying ourselves food, has a purifying effect on us spiritually, and it helps to teach us that lesson of denying ourselves of things we would like in order to be more focused on the other. So if you indulge me to go back to Dom Guéranger just one last time, this is what he teaches about this point. The whole man, both body and soul, is to be reformed by the practices of this holy season. Let us purify the soul by the confession of our sins, by compunction of heart, by the love of God, and let us give back its dignity to the body by making it bear the yoke of penance, so that it may henceforth be subservient and docile to the soul, and on the day of the general resurrection may partake in her endless bliss. Docility of the body to the soul. This is really docility to the will of God, which is why the church also places before us, for our reflection on this second Sunday of Lent, the example of Abraham. We heard about his call in the first reading. Imagine what it must have been like for him. This is the first one to whom God reveals himself and makes a covenant to be the father of his chosen people. So everything else, this is like the turning point in the book of Genesis. Everything else we might say is sort of like a blueprint. God charts out how he's going to do this. And then he begins the work of building from this blueprint, building his work of salvation with the call of Abraham. The first one, he calls him to leave his hometown, and that he would become the father of a great nation in which, as he says, all the communities of the earth shall find blessing. All the rest of the world was pagan. Nobody knew who the real God was. So this is the example of his obedience and faith. He stepped out with great faith, with trust in God as the first true believer, and to go to wherever it was that God would direct him, to go where he had never been before. And because he believed and obeyed, all nations have indeed been blessed through him. His physical descendants, the Jewish people who received the law from God through Moses on Mount Sinai, a law that came directly from God, a law not made by humans, it's a higher law. God gave this to his chosen people of old through his prophet Moses. And we who are the spiritual descendants of Abraham, who came, eventually God's plan was to include people of all nations. Our membership in the people of God is determined by faith, not by race. And Abraham is the model for us of the one who listened to God and obeyed and then was blessed, even though he seemed like someone very unlikely. He was an older man without any children, let alone sons, which was considered the great blessing of that time. He was not a great king, yet this is the one whom God blessed because of his trust and obedience. It shows what can happen when we have that kind of docility to God. That is the lesson of selflessness that this season of Lent is meant to teach us. Putting everything we have and are at God's disposition, fulfilling his will and giving him glory. We speak about the sharing of our gifts of time, talent, and treasure, which is our spirituality of stewardship, understanding everything that we have is a gift from God and it's meant to be shared generously in accordance with God's purposes to spread God's love and give him glory. The sharing of gifts of time, talent, and treasure correspond to the practices of Lent. Sharing more generously of our time through greater efforts in prayer, greater acts of charity, certainly sharing of treasure through our almsgiving, and also taking seriously acts of penance. It is very appropriate then that we have the Pueri Cantores and other choirs with us during this season of Lent, because this is a very good example of what I'm talking about here. They use their talents and energies to enhance our worship with true beauty, to help us worship reverently as much as possible. They use their talents and energies to give God glory and praise in this most important action, human action, of worshiping God, helping to instill a sense of right worship to God, worship that is truly befitting God's house. We should always want to give God our best, most especially when we come to worship him, because this is the highest act that we, whom he has created, can do. This is what he created us for, to worship him, so we can eventually find communion with him. It is good that we repeat this season of Lent every year, because the lesson it teaches us is one that we have to learn and then constantly relearn all throughout life. Let us then take advantage of this season of salvation so that we may be properly prepared to celebrate our Lord's victory over death at Easter and so be renewed in hope for eternal life with him and strengthened to live in accordance with the dignity that he has given us. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. In his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified,
who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us turn now to the Eternal Father, counting on his unfailing mercy and entrusting to him our needs.
For the Church, that her leaders, especially Pope Francis and all bishops in communion with him, may bear their share of hardship for the gospel with strength that comes from God alone. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For peace among nations, that these days of prayer, fasting, and almsgiving may encourage government officials in their efforts toward peace and conciliation. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For an increase of vocations to the priesthood and consecrated life, that young men and women, especially here in this Archdiocese of San Francisco, may be given the grace to listen and respond to the call of Christ, the beloved Son of God. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the health of all the sick and for those in need of prayers, especially that the Lord may satisfy their every longing, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the repose of the soul of John O'Malley, for whom this Mass is being offered, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the faithful departed, especially for Father David Pintengall and Father Michael Briantes, that Christ, the just and merciful judge, may grant their souls a place of eternal rest, light, and peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Most merciful Father, you did not spare your own Son, but handed him over for us. May we always listen to him and trust that you will always grant what we need to make progress on the way to salvation. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name,
for our good and the good of all his holy church.
May this sacrifice, O Lord, we pray, cleanse us of our faults and sanctify our faithful in body and mind. For the celebration of the Paschal festivities, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your heart. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord, For after he had told the disciples of his coming death, on the holy mountain he manifested to them his glory, to show even by the testimony of the law and the prophets that the passion leads to the glory of the resurrection. And so with the powers of heaven, we worship you constantly on earth, and before your majesty without end we acclaim.
Sanctus, Sanctus, Sanctus Dominus Deus Sabaoth, Pleni sunt Caeli et Terra Gloria Tua, Hosanna in excelsis.
To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and blemished sacrifices, by which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and me, our unworthy servant, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls and hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas, and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers in all things we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
the mystery of faith.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them, as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who, through this participation at the altar, receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share and fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Isaiah, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with
your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter
under my roof,
but only say the word,
and my soul shall be healed. We invite practicing Catholics who are prepared to receive Holy Communion today forward at this time, remembering that if you're wearing a mask, please lower it beneath your chin as you approach the host. All others who are present with us today are welcome and encouraged to join with us in prayer and song.
You are the most handsome of the sons of
righteousness is poured out upon your lips. For God has blessed you forevermore. Tell no one about the vision you have seen until the Son of Man has risen from the dead. Gird your sword upon your thigh, O mighty one. With your splendor and your majesty, in your majesty, ride on triumphant in the cause of truth, meekness, and justice. May your right hand show your wondrous deeds. Tell no one about the vision you have seen until the Son of Man has risen from the dead. Your arrows are sharp, peoples fall beneath you. In the heart of the foes of the king, tell no until the Son of Man has risen from the dead.
Thank you.
The second collection this weekend supports the Cathedral Music Program. Thank you for your generous support of this essential component of our cathedral liturgy.
Let us pray. As we receive these glorious mysteries, we make thanksgiving to you, O Lord, for allowing us while still on earth to be partakers even now of the things of heaven through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Good evening. The musical meditation for Sunday, February 5th features Friedrich Edelmann on the bassoon with Rebecca Rust on the cello, performing at 4 p.m. Please remember Father David Penningill and Father Michael Briantes, who were lost to us during the course of the past week. Father Pettingill's funeral mass will take place here in the cathedral on Monday, March 6th at 10 o'clock a.m., followed by reception downstairs. Each Friday during Lent, we will offer the Stations of the Cross in English right after the 12:10 Mass and in Spanish at 7 p.m. The Via Crucis in Spanish is followed by a soup supper in the parish hall. There is a Lenten preaching series taking place this week in San Francisco at other parish locations as a part of the Archdiocesan Eucharistic Revival Movement. The details are found in the bulletin, along with a QR code to link you to the entire series. Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow down for the blessing.
Bless your faithful, we pray, O Lord, with a blessing that endures forever, and keep them faithful to the gospel of your only begotten Son, so that they may always desire and at last attain that glory whose beauty he showed in his own body, to the amazement of his apostles, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.